Rivers around the Great Lakes region are being cleaned up and restored. But what happens to the creatures who call the river home once that work begins?
River restoration projects typically include removing or adding material to the river bottom, and that creates a problem. Native freshwater mussels live on the river bottom. And if the river is going to recover, the mussels need to survive the restoration process. The solution is to bring in a team of specialized divers to find and remove the mussels before the bulldozers arrive. That's where people like Ryan Schwegman come in. He's the COO of consulting firm BioSurvey Group.
I've done this work all over the eastern United States, so just this year I've been in the Adirondacks in New York, Mississippi River in Iowa, in Ohio, now here we are in Michigan. We pretty much travel all over the place to do this.
BioSurvey Group is based in Ohio. But in September of 2024, Ryan's team was in Grand Rapids, Michigan, searching for endangered snuffbox mussels in the Grand River.
We specialize in doing endangered species work and surveys for those, so we also do other services besides freshwater mussels.
The divers were able to systematically search 40,000 square meters of the Grand River by following a series of lines secured to the river bottom.
Each one of the transects are marked on the upstream and downstream side with a GPS unit. They're about 10 centimeters plus or minus accuracy, so they're pretty accurate. And we pin those out there and then pull the line straight and connect those. So all they gotta do is follow the line. They have a 2 meter wide by 1 meter tall grid, and that's divided into 2 1-by-1 cells. So they go out, they look at that 1-by-1 cell, they're fanning the substrates and looking for freshwater mussels. They look over that area multiple times and then they'll flip that over and repeat the process.
Leah Dan was one of the scientific divers searching for mussels in the Grand River.
You can kind of sometimes just see them poking a little bit up out of the substrate, and then we'll start moving rocks and stuff and wafting the sand and silt and stuff and just try and get about 6 inches deep. If we find some, we usually do another scan just to make sure we haven't missed anything. So we'll just keep scanning until we've had a really thorough look and haven't been finding any more.
They all carry a little bag with them and they put the mussels in the bag. When that transect is done, they take all the data and that goes over to our species specialist, our malacologist, who will ID all those and record what individuals we found on each transect.
Heidi Dunn is a founding member of the Freshwater Mollusk Conservation Society and the lead mussel expert on the Grand River Project.
I got introduced to freshwater mussels in 1978 when I was an intern with the Fish and Wildlife Service. And then from there, I started working at another consulting company, and pretty soon I just became a specialist.
After identifying each mussel species, Heidi uses a grinding wheel to mark the shells. The shallow grooves serve two purposes.
When we go back to monitor these animals that we have moved, we want to be able to identify the animals that we've relocated as opposed to those that were already there. We grind it to the edge, the ventral edge of the animal. Any shell material that's laid past that is growth. So then we know they're feeding and they're growing and they should be happy. The federally endangered species are also pit tagging. It's a passive integrated transponder tag, which then we can wave a wand over the substrate and find those animals.
The dive crew was able to complete the Grand River job in just 3 weeks.
Normally, you know, you'd have a crew, which might consist of 3 or 4 divers. We're here, we've had over 20 people in the water almost the entire time. And with the low, low water conditions, we were able to snorkel more than we had to dive, which is always a lot more efficient.
The conditions are not always so favorable. In some rivers, like the Mississippi, the water is so murky the divers use touch rather than sight to find the mussels.
In comparison to doing Mississippi, where it's maybe fast, zero vis, very equipment intensive, this is definitely on the more enjoyable side of the things we do. When you're looking for mussels in zero vis, it just becomes a skill set that you acquire over time. You feel the density differences, the shapes. It's hard to kind of imagine if you've never done it, but eventually it just becomes kind of second nature.
ZeroVis stuff. I mean, there's something fun about that too, like relying on the tactile. But yeah, it's definitely nice when it's crystal clear.
A lot of the ZeroVis stuff, they actually excavate everything in the cell and they put it in a bag and then it gets sorted on the surface.
The dive work can be physically demanding.
Sometimes we just have hard days where it's really cold or there's so much current that, like the other day, I was wearing 70 pounds to try and stay down. We're usually in the water by 8:30, and then we usually try and finish up in the water around 4:30, around 8, 8 and a half in the river, and then sort of 10 to 11 hour days total.
Hours of immersion, even in freshwater rivers, create issues for the divers.
You get cuts that don't heal and weird rashes and ear infections, and we're always putting in swimmer's ear. The rashes are a bit of a pain, but yeah, we're all very, very good about keeping any wounds clean.
So, why take the risks and go to all this effort just for a few mussels?
Because freshwater mussels are an integral part of our riverine ecosystem. They're kind of the livers of the river. They sit in the bottom of the river. At one time, it was 50 to 100 per square meter.
There aren't that many mussels anymore. One reason? Mother of pearl buttons, which are actually made from the lustrous inner shell of freshwater mussels. The abundant mussels in North American rivers led to a mother of pearl button industry boom from 1890 to 1940. A single factory on the Mississippi River produced a staggering 1.5 billion buttons in 1905 alone. This over-harvesting decimated mussel populations, and soon river systems began to break down.
They cleaned up the rivers for us. They took the nutrients out of the water column and put it down into the substrate where it was available for invertebrates, which are fish food. It also stabilized the substrate and made substrate for invertebrates to colonize, and then that attracts fish. And of course, then that completes the life cycle.
Native fish and native mussels depend on one another. The mussels help ensure a food supply for the fish, and the fish help the mussels reproduce and spread. Although the fish don't exactly volunteer, so the freshwater mussels have developed a clever way to trick the fish into helping them.
The thing that's special about them is they all require a fish host to complete their life cycle, and they all evolved in freshwater systems.
To attract their desired fish, the mussels use their fleshing mantles to create tempting lures. Snuffbox mussels try to attract log perch.
They have little flaps that they flap around to attract the log perch. So the log perch comes in to see what's happening, and she closes her shells on his nose and holds him in place, and then pumps her glaucidia or larvae into his gills. But then his friends come over too, and they get a few glaucidia on them, and so it populates a whole bunch of fish. Then the fish encapsulates them, and they ride around on the fish for a few weeks, and they drop off, hopefully in good habitat. Those log perch can move between mussel beds, etc., so that, you know, distributes the gene pool.
Freshwater mussels play such an important role in maintaining healthy river systems that saving them is a key component of many river restoration projects.
I'm in the water or processing mussels for 8 to 12 hours a day and loving it. And it feels good to be doing something that matters. You know, I think it's really important that what we're doing helps the ecosystem.
If you have a good mollusk population down there, you have a functioning river system.
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe, and check out our YouTube channel for even more Great Lakes Now. See you out on the lakes.